enjoy your tea. And thank first you. Of all, I would like to say great show.
Oh, thanks.
It was good. Although thanks. You're ill, it was really good.
Thank you very much.
And I like the last song.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Is it going to be on the album?
It will be on the album.
Okay, great. First of all, Zach, are you really that unstable?
Yeah, for sure.
Why?
Like, I think anyone who does music, like, or writes music anyway, or has a job which is slightly unstructured, like, if I write a good song, I'm happy. And then if I write a bad song or if I sing badly at a show or something, I'm, like, sad for the rest of the day. So, I'd say...
And is that what the song Unstable is really about? Or
The song is about... I guess it's a bit deeper than that. But it's kind of about... It is about my own instability. Like, just some days I'm really, like, effective as a human being and happy and, you know, I can think properly. And then other days I'm... like depressed or like down or just in a rut or something, you know, and I wanted to talk about that, but also how it affects the people I love around me, you know, and so that's what the song's about, basically.
Okay, you've also hit rock bottom. You're kind of dark, actually.
It's about having an extremely firm buttocks.
What buttocks?
It's about having an extremely firm buttocks.
No, it's not. No.
No, it's not.
No. But it's a great song. And Wretch 32, is that his name?
Yeah. Wretch 32, yeah.
We don't really know him in Belgium. Okay. Is he fun to work with? What kind of guy is he?
I've only met him a couple of times.
Oh, yeah.
But he seems like a lovely guy. Yeah. And his lyrics on Rock Bottom are amazing. Mm-hmm. Like, it took me a while, like, it took me a couple of listens to actually realize what he was saying.
And how did the collaboration come together? Did you know each other, or?
Sorry, I'm a slurper.
No, it's okay.
It was initially for his album.
Oh, okay.
And then, I had just like one hook on it or something, and then it ended up not being on his album, and then I still loved the song, and so
really
I thought, let's try and make it a proper song, and so I wrote like two verses and like changed the chorus, and I was like, okay, I've done my bit now. Do you want to change your rap bit? And then he changed what it was about, and then kind of.
Do you have a kind of collaboration bucket list lying around somewhere?
For sure.
Who's on it?
I would love to work with Pharrell in some capacity someday. I think two UK artists that I definitely love to work with are Stormzy and Skepta. I think they're incredible. And who else would I love to work with?
No women?
I love to work with Ella Eyre.
Yeah, she's great.
I think
great.
She has one of the most amazing voices.
I
know. Who else would I love to work with? Obviously Adele. Mm. But I think that would be a long way off yet. Let's see. I've actually done a very quick writing session with Stormzy.
Really?
Like early doors. But it was so quick, we didn't actually get a chance to like probably finish something. But hopefully in the future we'll be able to work on something.
And I saw your 30-second cover of Bobby Womack.
Yeah.
What if you could choose one person, one artist, dead or alive,
who you had
to do a collaboration with?
Why just one?
I don't know, because it's a hard question.
Okay,
you can pick two if you really can choose.
Michael Jackson would be an obvious one. I think he's just the greatest, like, dude of all time, like, musician. And also his producer / songwriter, and a guy who recently passed away. What is his name? Man, I forgot his name. This is bad. Rod Temperton.
Okay.
I'd love to work with him. He's written some of the biggest songs ever, and like not many people know him, but I'd love to work with him. Bill Withers is still alive, and I would definitely love to write with him. The way he can like say something so simple, but it's so profound.
Like what?
Maybe the lateness of the hour makes me feel bluer than I am.
You tweeted that.
Yeah, that's, how do you know this stuff?
No, I stalk you on Twitter, yeah.
Yeah, that's such a cool way to say it. Like, because there's always times where like there's like a situation and it's only at night that it really bugs you, and then when you wake up you're like, it's not that bad. It just do that. Okay, cool. Yeah. But like,
true. true. Your album is coming out the 21st of April. What are you gonna do that day?
I was actually recently planning this. So I reckon I'm definitely gonna have like a launch party somehow, but I reckon it'll be something interesting. But I'm not gonna say anything just yet.
Oh, come on, just a little bit.
No, I can't. It will be, it might be something sport related.
Really?
Maybe.
Okay.
Maybe.
Okay, I'm not gonna ask anymore.
No.
Are you excited for the album, or are you also kind of scared because now you can't change anything about it anymore once it's out?
No, I think I can't change anything anyway. Mm. And I love the stuff I've made. Like, I really feel like I gave it everything I had. And so I'm ready to put it out there and now let other people hear what I've been working on. Mm. And also kind of move on to the live stuff and, you know, touring the album and all the other things that follow from it. So,
what do you like the most, performing or sitting in a studio and making songs?
I like both. They're very different. Very different. Like, performing live is like adrenaline and energy and emotion and connection with an audience. And then in the studio, it's more kind of feeling, but you're not performing to anyone. It's just yourself, you know. You're kind of vibing with yourself or the producer or something. And then, and you know, you have time to think and you have time to tweak and change, you know, so it's different. I like both.
The album is called Only When We're Naked. Mm. When did you come up with that title?
So I came up with that title after I wrote a song called Only When We're Naked. And the song is about getting naked, not necessarily it could be in a physical way, but also just kind of stripping away the layers. Mm-hmm. And like getting rid of like the defenses and stuff and the fakeness that all of us have at some, you know, we're all guarded at in certain situations. And basically the premise is that only when we get rid of these barriers can we be our true, like, authentic selves. And so that was the premise of that song. And it made me think about the whole album. Like, that's what I wanted to be, like, as open and honest as possible. And so I thought that was a good way of saying it.
Yeah, I do get the impression that your songs are honest and open. And
yeah.
So that's what we can expect from the album also.
Yes.
Okay, awesome. Are you a person that can let things go by writing about them or writing it off of you, as we say in Belgium, but I don't think that's writing the way to say it in English.
I think that a better way for me to think about letting go is accepting things to be just as they are. So that's something I'm definitely working on, just learning how to deal with change and learning how to accept any situation for what it is, and then and not you know, wish things were different, you know, because things being different, like, doesn't really exist, you know.
No, it's just now and here and
exactly. Yeah. So I'd say, yeah, like when I wrote Unstable, definitely writing about it made me really experience it and understand how I was feeling better. And I actually wrote it with three other people that had all experienced the same kind of feelings, but in a slightly different way. And so it was an amazing experience to talk about the same thing just from different perspectives. And like, the people I wrote it with are around the same age, like they're a bit older than me, but like, they had experienced the same feeling. And that was so beautiful, knowing that we'd all connected on this one subject, and we felt the same way, and we could write about it from a place of like, I actually know what this feels like, you know. Mm-hmm. I've actually been in this situation enough to talk about it confidently, you know. So,
do you think that's why the song is so popular right now? Because so many people can relate to it.
I hope so. I mean, that's definitely one of my goals, is to have music that I like and I really feel emotionally attached to, but also that other people can relate to it as well and feel like they belong or they're accepted in some way, you know, because, you know, we all feel the same things, maybe in different orders in our lives, but we all feel the same thing. Yeah. It's the human condition.
And how does it feel to have this many people liking your song? Because it's going really fast right now. Your life is gonna change, you know.
Yeah, I guess I just gotta take it as it comes, really, when it does change, if and when it does, you know. It feels amazing to have. I've never had a song like this where so many people are listening to it and are affected by it. Like, it feels amazing.
But you do have kind of already a fan base, because...
Yeah, like, yeah, still, like, from an objective point of view, it's quite a lot of people.
Yeah, sure.
So, yeah, but I think, like, it's, you know, the fan base is definitely growing. I'm humbled by that. It's good.
Yeah, you're a humble kind of person. You're really down to earth.
Oh, cheers.
That's a good thing, so cheers. Keep it that way. You also did a cover of Ed Sheeran's Shape of You.
I did.
Which song do you like the best, Shape of You or Castle on the Hill?
Say that again, sorry.
Castle on the Hill is his other song, and Shape of You came out on the same day. Do you have a preference for one?
They're both so different.
Yeah.
I like both of them. I can't really. They're very different. Like, I love the way that in Shape of You he's like taken really catchy melody and like it's so recognizable, and the beat as well. Like, it's so simple but it's so catchy. And, and then in Castle on the Hill, again, I think melody wise he's just amazing. Like, the songwriting is unbelievable.
Would you like to write with him, maybe, a song?
Yeah, I would love to write with him. Probably should have written him. I should have said that. But, yeah.
Do you also have time for other stuff besides music?
I'm really into chess at the moment.
Oh, really?
I've never played chess before, but I moved into this new flat with, like, some really close friends.
Yeah.
And they're really smart. Like, really smart. And so, like, there was a chess board there, and one of them's like amazing at chess. His name is Jamie. If you're watching this, Jamie, hello, I'll see you later. yeah, he taught me and my mate Tom, who I also live with, how to play chess. And we've just kind of been like battling each other.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got quite aggressive. Like, we've had a couple of like full-on fights where
really?
He's broken my... No, I'm kidding.
No,
it gets a bit competitive.
But you're getting good at it.
I'm getting better at chess, which to most people is so irrelevant, but to me it means so much. And I used to play table tennis quite a bit, and so I'm still kind of playing, not really though.
Mm-hmm.
Like, every so often if I have time I'll go to my old coach's club and play a little bit, but other than that, yeah, I'm free.
You did it in your music video.
I did do that.
Everybody needs love.
This is very true.
Did you do it in one take or not?
I did.
Really?
Yeah.
That's impressive.
I did. I was very out of breath by the end of it. I won't be doing that again.
Okay. I told you before, I host the show 20 something,
mm-hmm.
that's the name, with only music from 2000 up until now.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to know your three favorite songs from this century, if you had to choose three. Because the item is called Trio, mm-hmm. a threesome, so we're gonna do a threesome on the radio.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Are you getting involved in this as well? No. All right, so number one I'd say is Crazy by Gnarls Barkley.
Why?
Because, okay, let's break it down. So melody is unbelievable. Like, it's so catchy and like everyone sings it. Like, I did a show at Scala in London recently, and I got the crowd to sing it with me, and it was so cool. Everyone knew it. Lyrically though as well, like, I think it's a really cool, for me anyway, this is what it means. It means that when you're pursuing anything, like, you know, the pursuit of happiness or success in whatever, you're gonna go a little bit crazy, you know, like the pressure and like, you know, just that kind of drive, like, it can make you think in different ways, and to other people, they're like, oh, I want to do that, and in fact, any pursuit in any area of life is difficult,
mm-hmm.
And you can lose yourself a little bit, and I feel like that's what he's talking about, but he talks about it in such an interesting way, so yeah, I love that song for that reason.
Great, I'm gonna put it on the radio then.
Cool.
Song number two.
Cool. Song number two is Holocene by Bon Iver.
Hi.
So I remember going to school and getting up at like 7 and getting the bus in like a rainy London morning, like on a rainy London morning, and listening to that song, and it's got such a warm feel to it, and I guess it counteracted the cold of the London air.
Wow.
But like it's such a, I don't know, I just love Bon Iver. It's such a beautiful song, and yeah, I'm so glad that now he's like getting the recognition that, or they, I suppose, mm-hmm. are getting the recognition they deserve.
Yeah, great.
Number three, I always forget the name of this song, but it goes dun, 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 walk away. It's the Justin Timberlake. What's it called?
Is it Rock Your Body?
That's the one. Yeah. Rock Your Body. I used to go to this like youth club when I was like 10, 11, mm-hmm. and I had this girlfriend at the time, mm-hmm. and like I was a late bloomer like growing up. I think I was like 5 foot or like 4 foot nine,
okay.
as an 11-year-old. And I think she was about 5'5".
Okay.
And she was quite a tall 11-year-old. And we would dance at this youth club. And I'm pretty sure I had my first proper kiss with this girl who was really tall.
Tall girl, yeah.
And that song was playing. And so I always remember it.
Aww.
Because of that. She used to wear this like really like sparkly lipstick. And then I wore it consequently when we kissed.
At 11 years old.
At 11 years old.
Okay, yeah. Great. Thank you so much for the lovely talk. No, I do have one last question because...
Definitely ask it then.
Yeah. From a Belgian fan. Her name is Louise van Buggenhout.
Say that again.
And Louise.
Louise.
Van Buggenhout, but that's our last
Van Buggenhout.
Yeah, really good.
Van Buggenhout.
And she wants to know in which city or on what festival you like to play the most.
Wow. I haven't really been to that many cities or countries for music yet.
Say Belgium.
But the number one is Belgium, always. yeah.
No, but when are you going to do a full show in Belgium?
Hopefully as soon as possible. Yeah, let's see how Unstable does in Belgium. And
it's doing great.
Yeah. I had some really good news today, so yeah. Hopefully as soon as possible.
Awesome. I will see you soon, and I'm looking forward to the album. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Done! Q Music. You make us Q.